Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome everybody to the April 4th, 2016 meeting at Alamance County Commissioners. And before we start, I would like to call on Ms. Massey to do our invocation.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to do the business of Alamance County. And just pray that we will do what is right and not anything that is wrong. And just pray that we do everything that God looks down on us with and I've got a throat stump. And that we can do God's work. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and do the pledge, please.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you very much. Before we do our public speakers, I have a plaque here in recognition and respect for Commissioner Dan Engle. And I'm going to just read this out loud. And it's with sadness I come today to do the gavel. But Commissioner Dan Engle has served a lifelong career in public service. Commissioner Engle retired from a career in law enforcement in which he worked for several law enforcement agencies. Once he retired from law enforcement, he did not sit at home. Commissioner Engle ran for Alamance County Commissioner and won election in 2004 and re-election in 2008. He resigned from his post as County Commissioner in June 2009 due to being appointed to serve out an unexpired term in the State House of Representatives. Commissioner Engle was elected to another term in the General Assembly. After serving 2 years in the legislature, he decided it was time to come back to Alamance County. In 2014, he won another seat on the Board of County Commissioners and was elected chairman. Commissioner Engle has served on multiple boards and committees, including the Alamance County College Board of Trustees, ABS Joint Facility Task Force, and the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Board of Directors. Mr. Engle has always been a voice for the residents of Alamance County. He has been a strong supporter of education, and now we want to express our gratitude to an individual who has made a difference in Alamance County. We are thankful for his invaluable and dedicated public service and express our sincere appreciation and respect on behalf of the citizens of Alamance County. And Dan's not with us today, but we will make sure he gets this. And if any of the commissioners would like to make a comment, feel free to.
Well, I'll say that Dan's been a mentor to me, new at this in this role as a commissioner. And I just really appreciate the way he's conducted business for the county and represented the county as our chairman, and just the way he supported education and the things that are really important in our community. So I'm really going to miss him personally, and I think the entire county is going to miss him greatly.
I think you're right. Any others? All right. And Craig, I guess you will take care of getting this to Mr. Engle. And as I said, it's with sadness that I did the gavel this morning. I appreciate his leadership here very much. Okay, before we do public speaking, Lash Reitenberry has a brief presentation for the sheriff, and if he will come up and do that, I would appreciate it.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
About 6 months ago, my son, who is a deputy with the Alamance County Sheriff's Department, approached me. He said, "Dad, I want to put a 'In God We Trust' bumper sticker on my car." Well, that really made me feel great. So I called Terry, and Terry said yes, that somebody had already approached him and they were going to get them. So this past week, I checked with Terry again and they had not been received. So I contacted Karen Dozier, if you'll stand up, with Pip Printing, and asked Karen's help. So today, I have 200 bumper stickers that have been donated by Pip Triad Signs to give to our sheriff, because in today's world that we're living in, we need our God. I don't know whether any of you, I know Eddie has and I know Bob has. If you've never ridden with a deputy, you need to ride with one. I wouldn't want to go to the door of a house at 2 o'clock in the morning for a domestic violence call unless God was standing beside me. Makes me feel very proud that my son feels the same way. It makes me very proud that we have a sheriff and a chief deputy that I know both are good Christian men that are leading our sheriff's department. So Terry, if you would walk up here, we'll give you the first one.
Thank you, sir.
Love you, my brother. You too.
Thank you, Pip Redding.
You're welcome.
A donation. We'll say get on the cars.
Thank you, Sheriff, for what you did. Thanks to the deputies, too. All right, public speakers. We have one, Tony Cox.
For the record, I go by the name Tony O. Cox. I reserve all my natural and inherent rights given to me under the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, and everything else that America is supposed to stand for. I do not consent to your illegal public comment rules. You dole them out as you want. Last week, I stopped operating my business, Tony Cox, DBA Affordable Plumbing Service and Repair, based on documents I recently received from the North Carolina Plumbing Licensing Board, showing that now, looking at those documents, there are a history of being retaliated against by your county attorney, some members, and possibly all members of this Alamance County Planning Commissioners. I demand that you call in the proper authorities, to include the Department of Justice, to investigate documents, recordings, and other evidence that I have that I believe will show criminal wrongdoing. I hear about God. It's amazing to me, totally amazing. I watch people with their different gods, and then I watch their actions and I say, God, look at how evil that God is. An evil God. And it ain't just one. I've heard people say all Muslims are bad, but they say not all Christians are good. Oh boy, boy. I used to believe in my government totally. I stood right here at this podium I think it was 2012, and I held a document up that said Tony Cox can continue operating his business. I said that I had been scared to run my business because of fear of retaliation. And based on those documents that I have been retaliated against. Here is a recording, according to your county attorney, that shows that he is illegally running his business. I was never notified. According to the documents, no calls. And then another document, dated 2015, here's the evidence. And I read that the result of that a couple of sub-meetings back. Call in the DOJ, start the investigation.
Thank you, Tony. Any commissioner responses? No. All right. Next, we have the approval of the agenda.
I move that we approve the agenda.
I second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. The consent agenda. Is there anything on here that anyone would like to pull to discuss?
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I think Mr. Reitenberry was signed up this
morning. Oh, I'm sorry, Lash. Okay, well, come on up here then. I let you speak one time.
you thought that's what he...
Okay, all right. I'm sorry. My bad there.
Good morning again.
You're lucky to get up here, too.
I know I am, and I feel lucky. What I'm about to say is going to be a surprise to my sheriff. I just told you about my son being a deputy with the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. Very proud of him. Folks, I've got one in each situation. I have a daughter that's a school teacher, and I have a son that's in law enforcement. Now, I support the schools 100%, and we give money to the schools, and I see a lot of the board members are here today. But the thing that we forget, without public safety, you can't have a safe school. We need to put more money into public safety. I have checked. The city of Burlington has approximately 80 patrol officers patrolling the streets of Burlington. Our sheriff has approximately 40 deputies patrolling Alamance County. What people don't see, a lot of times these municipalities, their officers get in trouble, they holler for the sheriff and the highway patrol. With 40 deputies, he can't do his job like he should do. He can't cover the county the way it should be covered. I'm asking you guys and ladies, in your budget, you ready? Give this man 10 more deputies. If we can look at building, which I think is ridiculous, a $50 million high school, and we can pay a school superintendent $300,000 a year, then we should be able to afford to give this man 10 more deputies. Because like I said, without public safety, you don't have safe schools. And what do? Every time somebody pulls in your driveway, walks out and starts raising cane, you won't call a police officer. Somebody knocks on your door at 2:00 in the morning, you won't call a police officer. You hope and pray that they've got one close enough by to get there before something happens. So I'm asking you guys to consider giving this man 10 more deputies, and he actually needs 20. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. It's Sorry about that, Lash. I really couldn't read your writing, son.
That's okay.
All right.
Consent agenda.
Let's do the consent agenda. Does anybody need anything pulled out of that? Hearing none.
I move we accept the consent agenda.
Second, please.
I'll second it.
Okay, thank you, Linda. All in favor of doing so, say aye.
Aye.
All right. Our next order of business today is a presentation. It's a proclamation for the Sexual Assault Awareness Month. And Julie, hey, I didn't even see you come in.
Thank you very much. We appreciate your support of the Sexual Assault Awareness Month proclamation. I'm Julie Budd with Crossroads. We are Alamance County Sexual Assault Response and Resource Center, as well as Child Advocacy Center. And I have some Elon students with me because they've been assisting. Come on. And they did sign up voluntarily to come to this 9 a.m. meeting. Obviously, they didn't sign up to take any 9 a.m. classes, but I'll let them introduce themselves.
Very good.
My name is Taylor Larson from Elon University, and it's good to be here today and have you guys supporting this cause. Thank you.
I'm Toby Venizio, also from Elon. I'm a sophomore student. Thank you guys for supporting this cause, too.
Very good. Well, Julie, I'd like to read this if you would like me to.
Yeah.
Number one, at the top it says, prevention is possible. Whereas Sexual Assault Awareness Month calls attention to the fact that sexual violence is widespread and impacts every person in this community. And whereas rape, sexual assault, sexual harassment harm our communities. And statistics show 1 in 5 women and 1 in 71 men will be raped at some point in their lives. Whereas child sexual abuse prevention must be a priority to confront the reality that 1 in 6 boys and 1 in 4 girls will experience a sexual assault before age 18. Whereas young people experience heightened rates of sexual violence and youth ages 12 to 17 were 2.5 times as likely to be victims of rape or sexual assault. Whereas on campus, 1 in 5 women and 1 in 16 men are sexually assaulted during their time in college. Whereas we must work together to educate our community about sexual violence prevention, supporting survivors, and speaking out against harmful attitudes and actions. And whereas prevention is possible when everyone gets involved. The first step in increasing education, awareness, and community involvement. It's time for all of us to take action and create a safer environment for all. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim the month of April 2016 as Sexual Assault Awareness Month in Alamance County, and we encourage all residents to recognize that each day of the year is an opportunity to prevent sexual violence and create change for the future. And with that, I'd like to present this to you from the Board of Commissioners. Thank you very much for what you do, Julie.
And we do was gracious enough, if I'll just pull this out, to help support us with the Monument Quilt, which is a national awareness and support for sexual assault survivors. So we have had many Monument Quilt workshops that we're survivors as well as supporters of survivors have been able to tell their stories. So we're going to be at the Mini Maker Fair at Holly Hill Mall on April 23rd. So if anyone wants to provide some more recognition of support or tell their story. And all these quilts are going to Washington, D.C. for 2017. They're going to spread them out along in front of the National Monument. It will be a National Monument to Sexual Assault Survivors. So we do want to thank Elon University for helping us with that with this program and invite anyone who wants to help. Thanks.
Thank you, Julie. And just a thought that passed my mind then. Isn't the Uncle Eli Quilt Festival this weekend? I know Pat Bailey usually would come and tell us all about that.
So yes, yeah, and so the quilters are actually going to be helping us stitch, stitch this down. Now, obviously, this is not your quilt of of Eli Whitley standards. It's more of a it's more of a banner, and it's been really touching to have people come and write their stories. Last year when we were at the Maker Fair, a gentleman walked up, and then as he walked away, he said, men are victims too. And so, and different people have just told their story, like this lady, my mother, my sister, they're survivors. Elon students, don't be afraid to tell like I was. Elon supports. So we've gotten a lot of community support, and we look forward to representing our sexual assault survivors in Washington, D.C. next year. Thanks.
Very good. Thank y'all so much for coming this morning.
Do you know Felicia Massey? She works for Elon.
Oh, good.
Thank you.
All right. Thank y'all very much. Any, Bob, would you like to make a response to that, or any of the commissioners?
No, I'm glad to see that this issue is being addressed, and happy to proclaim that April being Sexual Awareness, Assault Awareness Month. So.
Very good. Anybody else? No? All right. Next on our agenda, a request to set public hearing for the Planning Board Ordinance. Libby Hodges, would you step forward, please?
Good morning. I have submitted a request to have a public hearing for changes to the Planning Board Ordinance on April 18th. I apologize for the typos in the agenda. The changes were approved unanimously on March 10th. And we are aiming for the April 18th meeting to hold the public hearing. So these changes are fairly minor. I apologize also that there was no attachment. I've actually given you a paper copy, and if you approve the request, I'll have it up on the website by this afternoon for the public to review. And we also have copies in our office for anyone who would ever want to come and read it. The changes are to clarify voting status, determining residency, clarifying responsibilities, and make sure we don't have conflicting rules between the ordinance and the bylaws. This began as a review of attendance requirements for the board, because there was some confusion about that, and turned into an actual project to make sure that the right things were showing up in the ordinance that needed to show up in the ordinance, and the right things are showing up in the bylaws, and that the two didn't conflict.
Any comments to that?
Vice Chair, if I could mention, we may be canceling, I have that under the manager's update, the possibility of canceling the April 18th meeting. Commissioner Byrd and myself will be at the Stepping Up Conference. Department of Social Services received a grant that's paying for the full travel for five of us, I think.
Yes, sir.
Chief Deputy Britt will be there, Ms. Osborne, Mr. Byrd, and myself. So now with a board down one, would be down two on the 18th, so there's a possibility of the cancellation of that meeting. So
you have a recommendation of when we might want to do that?
Would be at the next meeting.
First meeting in May.
Yeah, the first meeting in May.
Okay.
And that'll be just fine.
That'll be all right. I'll make the motion that we set the first meeting in May for the public hearing.
Okay. And I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Very good.
May 2nd.
So we'll set that for May 2nd.
Great. Thank you very
much. Thank you, Libby, for what you do with the Planning Board. And I think part of that came from the fact that we were wanting to represent the whole county on that board, so thanks for working on that. All right. Next on our agenda is an overview of Allied Churches, and my friend Kim back there, I think, is going to help us out with that.
I was thinking he was planning on me being short.
Thank you.
Well,
you standing on a corner in a cold winter morning,
and freezing with nowhere to go. They are you, sleeping in a car or under a bridge, who hasn't seen a doctor for a long time, even though you've developed a terrible cough that lasts weeks. You, who can't disentangle yourself from the gang you joined because you owe them too much money. You, walking in the shadows because you don't know how to deal with the warrant you got for missing your visit with the probation officer. You, walking down a dark alley looking for the drug that will take away the gnawing pain inside of you and make you forget. You, emerging from a car that carries away a man old enough to be your grandfather, and the memory of that experience makes you feel sick. You, who can't understand why your mind gets so mixed up, and you don't get why you feel so violent sometimes. You, who was told you were sick and not welcome because you told your family you were gay. You, who went home with a stranger and did things you try to forget because you were desperate for a place to lay down your head and food to sustain you. You, dejected knowing you served your time for mistakes you made in your youth, only to find that no one will hire you or rent to you. You, who misses your family and wishes you could call them and they'd say, "Hey, I miss you too. Please come home. Everything is okay." You, who came home to your front door padlocked because a $75 past due water bill, because you could no longer bear to hear your child cry out with hunger. You, who finally got the courage to tell your parents you were a boy trapped inside a girl's body, and they slammed the door on the reality you were struggling to find. You, who walks alone with a child growing inside of you. You, someone who is resilient, lonely, funny, smart, creative, caring, and endearing. If you are one of these people, or one of the hundreds of Alamance County residents who face these and similar situations daily, where do you go? My name is Kim Crawford. I am the Executive Director of Allied Churches of Alamance County. We at Allied Churches advance our mission of providing emergency services in a safe and healthy environment while moving individuals towards self-sufficiency. We seek to provide meals, shelter, resources, and support in order to meet social, education, health, and other needs by serving the lonely, hungry, and homeless in Alamance County. We are sustained by the generosity of organizations and individual donations, contributions of food, and the commitment of volunteers. At Allied Churches, we've been working with our at-risk homeless population since the mid-80s. We believe a person's well-being and positive development are founded on their ability to meet the basic needs of food, shelter, and medical care. Our community must come to grips with the fact that today we have more and more who are homeless or at risk of becoming homeless. The embarrassing, ugly reality is that our residents are coming to us due to abuse, violence and neglect, unemployment and underemployment, chemical and alcohol dependency issues, limited or no access to medical care, limited or no access to quality educational opportunities, and a lack of quality affordable housing, to name a few. When people walk through our front door, they have nowhere else to go. They come to us for safety, food, shelter, housing, and a listening, caring adult. Because at Allied Churches, when we ask, "How are you?" we mean it. Our goal at Allied Churches is to assist everyone who walks through our doors to become self-sufficient, positively contributing members of our community. What does that mean? It means an investment in Allied Churches is an investment in our community. Programming at Allied Churches encourages and teaches self-sufficiency and independence in the form of housing, employment, health care, parenting, education, and emergency assistance. Our shelter operates 24/7 and provides temporary shelter for homeless men, women, and children. In 2015, there were 517 unique shelter guests, not 51 like the paper said yesterday. An average of 65 residents per night call Allied Churches home. Our average length of stay is 38 days. Evidence shows that the shorter the length of stay in a shelter, the more successful a person will be at escaping homelessness permanently. Allied Churches uses rapid rehousing and coordinated assessment in order to appropriately house individuals in the shortest amount of time possible. Rapid Rehousing uses short-term strategies to help individuals and families quickly move out of homelessness and into permanent housing. Beginning in January of last year, Allied Churches began operating as the Alamance County lead for coordinated assessment, a HUD-mandated program put in place to coordinate all homeless inquiries and intakes in a given area. Currently, over 15 agencies in Alamance County are coordinating with Allied Churches. Allied Churches operates lunch and dinner services for shelter residents and community members through our community kitchen, while also providing breakfast and dinner daily for shelter clients. In 2015, we served more than 55,000 meals, or close to 200 meals per day. Also, our food pantry, which operates out of our main facility on the Fisher Street, provides food for Alamance County residents every weekday. And the other, the Meba Manim Ministry at First Baptist Church, operates the third Tuesday of every month. In 2015, we distributed nearly 500,000 pounds of food to nearly 20,000 different people. Both programs rely heavily on donations of food, supplies, and funds, while volunteers provide the labor needed to run the kitchen and the pantry. Through our emergency assistance program, Allied Churches assists individuals with documented emergency needs, such as overdue electric, water, and gas bills. This is one of Alamance County's primary homeless prevention programs. As one of the three primary organizations with funds for such emergency needs, during this past year, allocation for our funding was reduced by 53%, meaning nearly 800 families monthly who were able to count on us to remain in their home are no longer able to do so. Today, we are meeting only 12 to 15% of the requests asked of us. Allied Churches believes the safe and trusting space in our Basic Needs Center and our Resource Day Center enables the homeless to reach out and begin the healing process. Equipped with the tools of self-knowledge and support, our residents can become healthy, productive members of our community, which aside from the obvious humane aspect, comes tremendous monetary savings to our community. At Allied Churches, we are proud to be part of Alamance County. We are proud to be that beacon of hope, actually a center of hope and change for Alamance County. I would encourage each of you to come to Allied Churches for a tour. Thank you for allowing me the time to speak with you today, this being my first official time speaking with you all. I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
First off, I just want to thank you, Kim, for what great work you do there. I wish I had some of that energy. She's like the Energizer Bunny. She really works for the people there at the Allied Churches, and I know where your heart is.
Thank you.
Yes. I'd like to echo that, Eddie, and add that I appreciate Kim very much. She's helping us in our Stepping Up campaign initiative with the mentally ill in our jails, and I see Kim everywhere in the community. She goes to the community council meetings. She serves on other committees that I'm on, and she's really plugged into our entire community, and that's great. Thank you. Such an asset
for our community. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Kim. All right. Next, we have Public Health Month Proclamation. I think Stacy must have that. I don't. So.
Okay. That means I'm reading it then.
You're the proclamator.
So, good morning. Thank you for allowing me to take this moment to highlight the great work that Alamance County has done to improve health over the years, and to recognize the work of public health and the county staff that make that possible. So if it's okay, I'll go ahead and start.
Certainly.
So a proclamation for Public Health Month, April 2016. Whereas we hereby recognize and acknowledge 78 years of public health service to the residents of Alamance County, as well as the vast contributions of these services to the quality of life in our communities. And whereas public health plays a crucial role in the foundation of good health and quality of life lived by working to immunize people against disease, by working to control environmental health hazards and infectious disease, by improving the health of mothers and children and promoting healthy behaviors in areas of tobacco use, physical activity, and nutrition, And whereas the Alamance County Health Department is an active partner in the county's emergency response to natural and man-made disasters, and is a critical component in the response to widespread disease outbreaks in our community, in which local health providers and partners dedicated more than 1,825 hours to public health preparedness and response planning in the last year. And whereas public health plays a critical role in eliminating health inequities and preventing chronic disease and injuries, resulting in improved productivity and decreased health care costs for all Alamance County residents. And whereas a continued focus on prevention in Alamance County has resulted in an increase in life expectancy from 58 years to 77.3 years, 0.3 very important, since 1938. And over the last 15 years, a more than 31% decrease in cardiovascular disease since 1999, a more than 41.4% decrease in teen pregnancy rates, as well as more than 24% decrease in overall infant mortality. And whereas public health strives to protect everyone who lives, works, or visits Alamance County from health threats and disasters through the successful use of new and existing initiatives and collaborative partnerships with a multitude of agencies in the community to find solutions to health issues. And now, therefore, we, you all, the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, do hereby proclaim April 2016 as Public Health Month in Alamance County and urge our citizens to recognize that public health is working to ensure that all residents of Alamance County are healthy.
Very good. Thank you. Anybody have comments they would like to make about that?
Well, I'd like to say, representing this board on the Board of Health, I concur with the importance of public health. And when I worked at the hospital, we had a wonderful relationship with the health department, and just real important partnerships that have been merged by the health department through the years that are just really important. And appreciate everything that Stacy does.
A lot of hard work. Really, Stacy, would you like to introduce some of the
absolutely
folks?
So I'd love to take this moment to
team
to thank not only the staff of the Alamance County Health Department and some of them here, Jana, you all know very well, Candy West, but also just all Alamance County employees and staff we welcome everyone into our public health family, and that you all are a big piece of what we do, that we couldn't do the work that we do without our commissioners, our own Board of Health, our county administration, our county attorney, who helps us a great deal, our DSS partners, our law enforcement partners, our first responders, even Allied Churches, who was here, our Parks and Recs folks as well. So we are... Public health is immense. That even though you're not necessarily a public health or a health department employee, you are a part of public health every day. So thank you all for all of that. And we invite you to our kickoff, which is Wednesday at 8 a.m., where we're going to do our public health kickoff at the health department with just a 15-minute walk to raise awareness. And if you all haven't already, please take a moment, and I encourage you to look at the community health assessment, which is our local charge to monitor and identify and address the health priorities of Alamance County. And the people of Alamance County actually help determine that. So you may hear a lot about county health rankings, and I would caution you a little bit about using those, as the methodology has changed and it's hard to compare 1 year to another using those county health rankings, though they get a lot of marketing. But a better assessment and a better tool to sort of really look at what the health in Alamance County is our community health assessment. Any questions?
Very good.
Where did you say the kickoff was Wednesday morning?
It's going to be at the health department. Okay. I think we're kicking off at environmental health, which is on the same campus as planning and inspections.
Right.
And
on Graham Hope Bill Road.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Side of
bright and early.
Very good. Thank you, Stacy. Anybody else comments? All right, very good.
Thank you
so much. And I'm thinking Tori will get us a copy to sign of that. I don't see one up here. Okay, next on our list is Miss Susan Osborne. Good morning.
Good morning. So I'll call to the podium my new deputy director and introduce Adrian Day, who's been with the agency for 22. I was going to say more than 20. And is recently, with the retirement of Linda Allison, moved into the deputy director position. So she's going to be presenting our brief agenda item this morning.
All right.
Good morning.
Welcome.
Good morning. Thank you for allowing us to be here. We are, at DSS, we are seeking approval to apply for a grant through the North Carolina Health and Human Services Department. The grant is the Community Response Program. It's intended to reduce the rate of child abuse and neglect and also reduce the number of children who are coming into foster care. In Alamance County this year, we've seen a significant increase in the number of children who are coming into care, as will it will be reflected in our budget when you see that. This grant will allow us to hire a full-time coordinator with benefits. It will also allow us to pay 25% of the salary of our trauma specialist who's already on staff. This grant is $100,000 for 3 years, and there's no county match with it. It will also allow us to continue the work that we've done through the Alamance Alliance, which is the grant that was through SAMHSA, that's no longer, but it will allow us to increase the programs that we've done through that. I'll take any questions that you might have.
So when I read the memo about this, it looks like a lot of this money, or maybe all of it, will be used for people who don't otherwise qualify for services.
That is correct.
But what you're saying is that these are people that still need the services.
That is correct. So it's for families who have had a valid CPS report, Child Protective Services report. Our social workers have gone in the home, and they found that there aren't any child protective service issues, but there are issues that the families need work on, and that it will allow our agency to have funds to be able to help those families through voluntary services.
Including the children that were being served under the SAMHSA grant.
Absolutely.
And the Alliance program.
Absolutely.
So you will pick up some of those cases from the SAMHSA grant?
We will. It's the same population that would be served.
And that's really more preventive. Kind of,
it is preventive.
That'll prevent things that are worse later on, like child abuse.
That's
or the
right.
need for foster care and things like that.
That's right.
Do we have any questions from commissioners?
Do we need a motion for?
I think we do need a motion, and it's no match to this. So.
That's correct.
I'll move that we move forward. Are we accepting the money, or are we applying for the grant? I'm not
we're
sure.
Applying.
We're applying
we're
for
applying.
The grant.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we don't have the money yet.
Right.
We're applying for the grant with no money.
I'll second.
Minutes. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Uh-huh.
Thank you.
All right. Financial software. Susan Roberts, our finance director, will update us on this. And I know this has been going on for several years, so hopefully we can get a little enlightened today.
Good morning. You are correct, Commissioner Boswell. This has been going on for over 2 years now. We started this process with knowing that there was a need for a new software package for Alamance County. The package that we have currently was one that was purchased back in the 80s, and we have used it. We have used the useful life out of the system, but it's time for an upgrade. We were able to have different companies to come in. We've talked to them to see, first of all, who was able to meet our needs, and we were able to narrow that down to two companies that came in, gave staff demonstration. We also included our social services department as well as health department to sit on those to look at what are all the opportunities for all users. As well, once we were able to do that, we narrowed it down that Tyler Technologies was the best solution for the county with their Munis application. They currently serve 52 counties and multiple municipalities in North Carolina and have a very strong users group. Once we were able to narrow that down, we were able to make site visits to Lincoln County. And there, I want to appreciate their staff. They let us come and spend as much time as we needed to look at their applications, get a feel for how the system worked. So before you this morning, I'm asking for a couple of things. Also throughout that process, let me back up just a minute, we realized that we had a need for a time and attendance application as well. That would capture the true time of our employees, our work day. It would help with leave balances, our FMLA. And Sherry can speak to the specifics of that if you have questions concerning that. The cost of the systems were through for Tyler Technologies, the data conversion is going to be $218,075 with equipment cost of $1,650 and estimated travel expenses of $47,268. Those are one-time expenses. What we will have after that is an annual fee for license and hosting of $238,358. With Kronos, the cost of data conversion is $58,000, and yearly service cost would be $90,864. And that is a yearly contract. With the Tyler Technologies contract, it would be for 7 years. And these two options best fit our needs. And what I am asking for the commissioners to approve today is, as you're aware, we set aside $300,000 in a prior year budget to be used for this project. So right now, for the fiscal year 15-16 needs, we need $84,583 to complete this project and to get it started. The yearly cost would be $329,222. That would just become part of our budget from year to year. So this, what we are asking you to do is to grant the authority to Craig, our county manager, to execute the contracts and to appropriate $84,583 from unassigned fund balance so that we can move forward with this process.
So I have a couple of questions. Yeah. How did you come up with the $300,000 estimate, and would you normally expect when the actual costs came in it was going to be so much higher?
That was just a good seed money. Mm-hmm. We weren't sure exactly how much the project was going to cost, so at that first year we asked the board for $300,000. There were some things that cost us to kind of step back and let's further examine to make sure that we were doing the proper steps and that we had the correct thing. So we knew that probably a system was going to cost about $1 million. And so looking forward, that's where we had started setting aside the money.
We knew it was going to be a multi-year project. Mm-hmm. So that was just to start us to move forward so that we would have money available moving forward. But so we knew it was going to be multi-year. Mm-hmm.
So we've been through this kind of process at the hospital, and I mean, it's kind of the same thing, although I don't, solution, as they say, that you're doing here is going to be a cloud-based mm-hmm. solution, where in the past we would spend a lot of money on hardware and then the licensing, and on the, you purchase the software and then have annual licensing fees. So you'd still have annual licensing fees.
Correct.
Either way.
Correct.
And I like the concept of the cloud-based. In your memo, you talked about the mm-hmm. security of that, and
yes.
And that's really the way to go these days, I believe.
And also, I do want to thank Bruce Walker and MIS for their help. We have run all the hardware and software issues by MIS as well to make sure that things were compatible, that they would be able to maintain and upkeep our software. So I want to thank Bruce for that work.
So I want to make sure everybody understands that this is for a number of functions that we really need
Correct.
To have to run the business of county government. So this
yes,
is
sir.
Accounts payable, it's for budgeting.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have a budgeting system now?
We
sort
have
of.
A function,
sort
but
of.
This one will this one will grant greater functionality to our departments
right.
and aid in that as well. This would be basically the entire structure of our financials. So we would be able to run accounts payable through this process as well as our general ledger. Human resources, their department, things would feed in and it would just all of it come together for our payroll, purchasing, and it's really the backbone of our system.
And what about accounts receivable? Is that something different? Or is
mm-hmm.
that
it would be included with this
included
as well.
In this
mm-hmm. It's included under the general ledger function.
So one, I had an email earlier about, don't we contract out our collections? Do we really need to pay this much? But it's really, and probably not all of our EMS collections,
EMS.
I think is what
right.
I'm trying
EMS
to
EMS collections.
Contract.
Mm-hmm. We're bringing in and it yes. has all these other functions. And
so then, every other department, we are handling that collection as well for in the finance department.
And I wanted to say too, I saw some blogging out there over the weekend about Kronos, and I went online to look at all the lawsuits that were suggested that was against Kronos, which is the time and attendance system.
Correct.
And none of them were concerning to me at all, I'll say that. And that Kronos is a very good product, I believe. I mean, we use that at the hospital. The entire Cone Health uses Kronos. And it is important to have a system like Kronos, if not Kronos. There's a lot of liability that I know of, and Sherry can probably attest to this. If you're not capturing hours correctly, you can really get in bad way with the wage and hour laws, and that could be a huge liability. So,
is this not Kronos, but something like Kronos? Is that what you're saying, Susan?
It's actually two different systems, Commissioner Smith. We would use Munis for our financial package, and then we would use Kronos for the time and attendance. But the two systems are able to talk to each other, so we would be able to take the information from the time and attendance, and it would feed over into our payroll system. And that would help greatly with staff.
So there are two systems you're asking for?
Yes, sir.
And that's the way the hospital does it, too. The time and attendance is separate, but it feeds into the rest of the payroll, which is all connected to the general ledger.
And then that goes to budgeting. Yes, everything is connected.
And also, if we look at payroll, we have really one payroll officer who does everything by hand. We right now do our timesheets by timesheets, which is by hand with hand calculations. So this will really upgrade, and kind of move us forward in keeping up with our HR functions.
Does this increase your budget $300,000 a year?
Yes, sir.
Not a year, though.
Yes, this would be for 7 years. Is the contract that we're looking at for Tyler?
That includes the licensing and the hosting.
The whole thing.
We would see an increase of $329,222 each
per
year.
Per year.
Yes, sir.
In your budget.
So
cover that.
So I guess, Mr. Manager, you're going to have to figure out how that balances with everything else that we need in the budget.
We've talked about this, and we're, with the board's approval today, we were already planning on that as a fixed cost moving forward in the budget.
I would say that.
With no tax increase.
We're going to have to deal with this issue, whether we do it now or
today or tomorrow.
We're going to incur substantial costs, and I think you're saying this is...
We have, how many programmers do we have?
Three
programmers for the COBOL system, and that's what they have been doing. We lost our lead programmer, Arlene
King.
I'm sorry, Arlene King retired in 2014 January. Bruce might want to speak.
Yeah, she retired last year, and she knew she was retiring, and she did about 2 years worth of training to her other programmers to maintain the current financial system. But that knowledge has gone away. And the most important thing about this system is the flexibility. So right now, if something changes, they have to dive in and try to, reprogram it. Whereas Munis, obviously modern systems, you can go in and just in 5 minutes make the adjustments based on any requests that you have or anything like that. So
there will be some offsetting cost savings over time.
Absolutely. On the hours put into the system.
Absolutely.
Also,
you can repurpose or reassign those programmers, or through attrition, wouldn't need to replace them for the functions that they're doing now.
And what I like is, like Bob said, it being a cloud-based program. Mm-hmm. Plus, I'm guessing we have a lot. We don't really have support with our other program as far as.
We have support, and it's in Bruce's staff.
We're limited.
Right, and I want to say that his staff has done a great job maintaining the system. But it's reached its limit, and it's time for an upgraded package.
And that was done when?
We are doing the job now, though, are we not?
We are.
The last system was put in what
it
year?
It was back in, I want to say, 1984.
84.
Yes, sir.
So that's over 30 years ago.
Over 30 years ago.
A lot of things breaking.
Software and computer technology has changed a lot.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, any other questions?
I don't see how we're going to do all of this and not raise taxes.
We're working hard.
Yes, we are.
Well,
working
there are a lot of moving parts in a budget. So,
Every year I hear that, and taxes are going up. So I'm sorry. If we're getting the job done now, I have to agree with the statement earlier that the sheriff needs at least 10 more deputies is more important to me, since we're doing the job that this system is supposed to take over. I can't understand it. Sorry, I'm a little thick.
Well, I would make the motion that we accept the staff's recommendation to move forward with this system, with both systems.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. We have the magistrate office modification. Brian Agood. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, commissioners. I'm here this morning to request that you approve spending up to $13,991 from the county's contingency fund and an additional up to $1,009 from the county's fund balance to make modifications to the Alamance County Magistrate Office over at the jail complex. The facility staff and staff from the Alamance County Sheriff's Office have took a trip up to Caswell County. Take a look at how their magistrate office is set up. The magistrates here requested that we do some modifying their space that they currently have. This project would create more storage area for the magistrates, an additional workspace. It would also make the public access windows safer and allow for some more discreet communication between the magistrates and the folks that come to see them. It is important that you understand approving this funding, if we use it all, will exhaust the contingency fund for the county. And of course, anything that we've estimated this project will cost no more than $15,000. That's why we're asking for this amount. If it comes in less than $15,000, of course, we wouldn't we'd leave the money in contingency or in the general fund. So, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
Where in the building is this located?
It's on the new jail side. When you come into the lobby, the magistrate's office is on the right when you first walk in.
And what are some of the safety issues that we're really...
We're adding a new window for folks. You know, they have a pretty good steady flow of people come through the magistrate's office, particularly after hours. One thing the new space will do is provide some more discreet communication. They get involuntary committals and some other sensitive criminal warrants being taken out, so we'll be able to separate those folks from general population of folks that are coming.
Okay. Any other questions, commissioners? Do I hear a motion to approve this?
So moved.
I'll second it.
Bob, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? None. All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Budget amendment for our health department.
So what I have before you today is a request for a budget amendment. The health department was allocated $43,405 by the North Carolina Division of Public Health to be used in our food, lodging, and institution sanitation programs. And this is where we go out and inspect. And because we were at 100%, we actually receive a little extra money for making sure that all of our inspections are up to date. And so what you have before you is that request. Revenue coming in is $43,405 to be used on supplies, including computer supplies, medical and scientific supplies. And the largest request is for vehicles. Our fleet is aging. So. Any questions?
All right. this is just going to be a pass-through from the state to
yes.
your department.
Is it? This is part of our allocation from the state.
All right. Do I hear any more comments to it?
No, I don't have any more comments. So I'll move approval.
And I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. It's on the county manager. We want to talk how we're going to keep those taxes without raising.
We will. We still are planning to meet budget workshops the week of April 11th and 18th. We're still trying to finalize those six sessions. They'll be in the afternoon. Hopefully we can get that to you in the next couple of days. With the retirement of Commissioner Engel, we're kind of juggling around a little bit. So we'll get those workshops to you, and we'll start the budget process and the budget presentations. One thing I do want to mention and introduce is Debbie Hatfield. Debbie, please stand up. Debbie is our new emergency management director. Debbie is basically the Dave Leonard of old. So when Dave Leonard went to the state, we stole Debbie from the state, from the Department of Emergency Management. Debbie had multiple years with the state. She also served in Rockingham County as their emergency management director. As the board's aware, with Dave's departure, we kind of split the duties. We didn't create a position, but we split the duties between Johnny Payne and our fire marshal's office, so Johnny can concentrate on being the fire marshal full-time. But we really decided that one of the areas we needed to work on and on our public safety was to have a person dedicated fully to emergency management. And with Debbie's background and experience, we're excited about the direction that she will take us with respect to emergency management. So,
very good.
But I did want to, Debbie's first day, she's been with us now an hour and 59 minutes.
So, well, welcome, Debbie, to Alamance County.
So her first day was today, so we appreciate Debbie being here. So
thank you.
Also, I do want to mention, as mentioned last time, with respect to County Government Month, that our Intro to County Government classes begins tomorrow at 2 p.m. And then second session, or the second part, will be Thursday at 2 p.m. And then we'll have the second session beginning on April 11th at 5:30, and also April 14th at 5:30. So they're the same thing, but one is offered during the afternoon and one's offered in the evening to give people different chances. So again, appreciate Tori's help in setting that up.
You want any of us to attend those? Or would we money things up if we did?
they might shoot at us when we come in.
If you can come, we'd love to have you. Okay. We'd love to have you. So the first one we're going to talk really about really what county government does and goes with the services. And I appreciate the work that staff has done trying to update our numbers. It's amazing just to look at the sheer volume of work that all our departments do, from EMS to CCOM to the Sheriff's Department. It is amazing just to look at the raw numbers and the raw data of the services that we provide on a daily basis. So we will be doing that, and that is all I have. And again, we are canceling the April 18th meeting with the board's approval.
So move.
I know it's our turn to make comments, and I want to go back to this budgeting workshop, and with Mr. Engel's departure, I'm not certain how the rest of the board feels, but I'm thinking that the party will appoint someone at the end of April, and I'm thinking that whoever that is, they're going to be voting on the budget coming up, and they need to sit through it too, right, David?
That's a good point.
Anyhow, it would be
you in a meeting. I may not go to those meetings.
I know. I'm just saying, if you have to go, they ought to have to go, whoever that appointee is. But my thoughts on that is, if they're going to be voting on a budget, it would be better to postpone that to the month of May if we can.
We can.
I know it's pushing it, but
our first meeting in May is May 2nd, so we would do it. Try to just do it the week of May 9th through the 13th. We'll try to just do it in 1 week. So that way we'll have still time at the end of May to make the manager's recommended budget.
I've just by head nod, is that okay by everybody?
So
okay.
I think that's a good idea.
Okay.
Very good. All right. Commissioner comments.
I have a request. I'd like to hear an update on the animal shelter. Where are we on that?
We are working with the municipalities and trying to come up with a funding formula. The figure of $5.2 million has been thrown out there. In talking with the city of Burlington and trying to hire an architect, we feel like we can do it for much less than that. but we still are trying to figure out what's the fairest way for the municipalities to fund their portion of the new capital. So there's been a lot of discussion. We're going to try to meet with the managers again this week. The city of Burlington has been running a lot of options. So we're moving forward, but we're trying to make sure that we can get municipalities on board as well.
Well, several of the smaller municipalities have objected to paying anything.
Yes, sir.
How in the world are you going to convince them? I mean, those folks pay county taxes just like everybody else does.
That's an option we've looked at. We've looked at it based off of, if...
I don't understand. Do we need a new animal shelter or do we not? I haven't heard anything. I think this board did vote to proceed to look into it, but I haven't heard a thing. It's been, 2 months since we voted to do that, and now we're still sitting here negotiating supposedly with parties who don't want to negotiate. Do we need it? I mean, I haven't seen any pictures of the animal shelter, that it's falling apart. I've heard that it is. We've had good citizens come in and say that it is. But if anything, all we need is a shell metal building out there. You can put up one of those and use a brick facade, make it look real good, real nice for Burlington. But other than that, I don't see, I've heard every time I talk to somebody, is got to have a Taj Mahal for the dogs and cats of Alamance County. This $5.2 million has really set some people on fire, and I just don't know whether we need it or not. Can we enlarge the one that's there? Can it be renovated? I mean, when you get into construction, you look at those things first before you go planning to build more and more and more.
Yes, sir, and I think that's part of what the holdup is at this point in the negotiation with the municipalities and looking at with the architect to see what the exact cost would be. And if you talk to the city of Burlington, they looked at it probably on the top end. But we also have to remember we are getting $750,000 of private dollars for this as well.
Well, that's not in writing yet either.
That was part of the motion, though, and Mr. Hunt stood right here and verified that they would do that.
I can't vote for $5.2 million for anything. We built the EMS center down here for $1.2 million, and that's for human beings. And we had an awful lot of things we had to get right, which you don't have to do in an animal shelter.
I agree. And I think our proposal was to put it out to see what could be done, right, to see what participation we had from other municipalities. Right. We didn't vote that night to spend that $5.2 million.
Right. That's right.
Because you made the motion, and I remember that. So, yeah. I know you wouldn't have said that. So,
right. No, the $5.2 million is not set and etched in stone at this time.
So it's still a process,
yes,
of working with municipalities, mm-hmm, figuring how much support,
right,
we have from all municipalities.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Go ahead.
We sent out proposals to architectural firms or not?
City of Burlington has, but I don't think one has been.
It's our responsibility.
They've kind of taken the lead since they operate the shelter. They have taken the lead on the construction and those type administrative issues.
Well, in the past, the county has sent out it to at least three architectural firms or any other firms that we may have on the list. To get proposals from them, and from what I'm hearing is we don't have any proposals coming in from any architectural firm, so we don't know how much it might cost or what type of building that we would have to put up if, again, we need a new building. Is that right? We don't know.
Well, I think it is definitely. We are in need of a building. It's figuring out how to go about approaching it.
We've been into this for 2 months, and I don't see any progress at all. Something's got to move along.
With Mr. Engel's departure, he was the other commissioner on the animal task force. I'm sure we could reconvene that group, and If you would like to participate, Mr. Smith, you'd be more than welcome.
Well, I think management should take care of these things. I don't need to be on that committee.
Okay.
When this was first presented to us, it was my understanding that this was being looked at by a group of both elected officials and appointed officials from throughout the community. So we had a lot of municipal representation. I thought it was an architectural firm's estimate of what was being proposed at that point. That's where we got the $5.2 million. I'm glad we're looking at it again because I'm hearing a lot of complaints
that's right.
Nobody would ever think of spending that much money on an animal shelter.
You have to back up.
So I'm glad that it's being scrutinized a little bit more. And I know that in a lot of counties, and when I've researched this, that counties provide animal shelters in lots of different ways, and sometimes it's through a private entity that's providing it using public dollars. Sometimes, in our case, it's a city that's taking the lead. But there's got to be county participation in it, and in some counties, it is the county that's doing it in providing the service directly.
I think my recommendation at this point was to reconvene the group that met, all the municipalities that were represented, and I think we need to sit down and just hash it out and figure out where we are and make another presentation to the commissioners to understand what our options.
Well, and I do understand Judge Smith's frustration with respect to the slowness of government, especially trying to negotiate with the municipalities and what is a fair amount and what is not a fair amount.
So now, Burlington has agreed to participate.
Burlington and Mebane.
Mebane has.
At this
Graham
point.
Has not, but Graham they all are on that board.
Graham has not. Gibsonville has not.
Right.
Hall River, sort of yes, sort of no. It depends. The smaller municipalities, we're still working with.
So I'm going to ask you if you could put a
yes,
meeting
sir.
Together of the group that
yes,
looked
sir.
At that, and
good
let's hash this out and bring it back, maybe as a second preview for the commissioners and to know where we are.
Be glad to.
Okay.
And now I'd like an update on the Knodel building.
It's still there. It is dried in. We have the electricity in our name. One of the things that this board has not done at this point with discussion facilities has decided how much or what we want to relocate, how much we want to spend, and what our next steps are. And that was going to be part of our overall facilities plan discussion.
We've had this building for 4 months. And to me, it's an insult to Knodel Clinic that they give us this building and we haven't done a thing in 4 months. Have we sent out proposals on this building to architectural firms to get people bidding rather than just talking to one local firm?
Well,
in the past, we've always sent it out to at least three whenever we go into construction.
No, sir, we have not.
No, we haven't done anything. That's all I needed to know. Thank you.
I do have a question for Richard. Wasn't there some asbestos and stuff had to be removed out of there?
No, I think it's relatively asbestos-free.
There's still some work that needs to be done in some hidden areas, but the work that was done a few months ago on doing a review of the building proved that it was in decent shape for that.
But you did have people over there because I saw some tape
yes, we hired
and so forth showing that
yes.
there was potentially hazard material
sure.
that they had to deal with in
sure.
that process.
So. One of the concerns is obviously pipe wrap, things like that are hidden issues, if you will. They're not easily to obtain. But
I think we have an estimate for what it would cost to remove asbestos from the building.
The abatement side of it to take care of that.
Yeah. Okay. You know, my perspective on facilities in general is that how many buildings do we have?
We're operating presently, I think, 38 at
580,000 square feet.
So we have 530,000?
About 579, I think.
580,000 square feet of space in 38 buildings. So, and I know having gone through this process before, when we merged two hospitals, there's a concept known as functional planning, and when you're looking at buildings, it's really important to figure out who needs to be located with whom to get the most efficient use out of your staff. And then there's the issue about if is there any way to even think about consolidating buildings so that we don't have so much square footage? I mean, I wonder how our county's 580,000 square feet compared to other counties in the buildings that they operate in, similar-sized counties, if it's anywhere near that. And what are we paying for utilities for all of that space? And we're probably occupying more space than we really need, only just because of the kind of buildings that we're in, perhaps. I mean, that's just something that should be looked at in a comprehensive facilities plan.
We are very diversified
when it comes to buildings.
So I'm not upset about kind of holding back on the Cronova building because I don't know if, I mean, we could invest, I think the original estimates were like $3 million in upfitting that building to put certain departments in there. And I'm just afraid of investing that much money in a building where it would be much wiser to invest money with a different facilities solution.
Well, I think case in point with that, Bob, is we had an inspection department planning over here. And how much was spent on that, Mr. Smith? You were a manager then. Do you remember?
No, I don't recall.
$274,992.
Okay. So that building is no longer there. So I think
we got $3 million for it.
It's prudent, though, that we look.
Not a bad investment.
And with that in mind, there's also a position open on the facility overview. So I welcome you to join me on that one, too.
No, pass.
Okay. Very good.
I think that's for management. That's what we pay management for, is to bring things to this board, not this board doing all of the work.
You know, we're doing a strategic plan, and I just have a sense, and Libby, I hope I'm not, where's Libby? There she is. Hope I'm not overstepping here. But it would seem like, you know, a lot of strategic plans has a facilities goal in it. And I mean, and I would think that our strategic plan probably needs to address facilities, because we spend a huge amount of our budget on facilities, and there's opportunity there. Again, if you co-locate people the right way, where you can share secretarial staff or reception staff and functions, and there's opportunities, perhaps, to save a lot of money.
And make
costs.
The taxpayer happy, because right. Sometimes things work better together.
Right.
And I know, just being a builder, that it's nice to be able to go to that part of town and go to environmental health, go to the inspection department to do Libby with the planning. I can do all three of those in one building, basically, because they're on the same campus. And sometimes you have to look at those things because the taxpayers see the result of our plan.
Right, from a service standpoint.
Yes. And I agree with you wholeheartedly with that. So, okay, any other comments? With that, we are adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.